Intellectual Property Creation and Management for Emerging Growth Technology Companies, Commercializing Intellectual Property. This presentation is brought to you by the IP attorneys and professionals at Halsey Intellectual Property Lawyers through the Halsey Intellectual Property Technology and Invention Monitor website. Halsey Intellectual Property Lawyers, IP professionals for entrepreneurship's new golden age. This presentation is part of the Technology and Invention Monitor website's Legal and Business Issues and Instructions resource. Intellectual Property Creation and Management for Emerging Growth Technology Companies, Commercializing Intellectual Property. Let's begin the presentation.
This module on the commercialization of technology, the commercialization of innovation, adds to the aspects of the intellectual property system the mechanisms for converting intellectual property into financial results, the commercialization decision of whether or not to commercialize a given technology, and then the decision on which type of mechanisms should be used or can be used for the purpose of commercializing the technology. This chart details some of the considerations having to do with a given technology and the strategic options that a company has before it, given the position that the company stands in relative to a particular technology. Looking at the diagram across the top, the columns indicate whether the complementary asset base of a company is weak or strong. By complementary assets, I mean the physical, the intellectual, the process, the other tangible and intangible resources that are necessary to take a given innovation and turn that innovation into a product, turn it into a financial result for the company. With regard to technology, looking at the technology, looking at the technology position of the company, the vertical axis here, I guess looking horizontally, the position can be either weak or strong for a given technology. The table helps to understand what the options may be for a company that has, for example, a strong technology position in terms of it being a leader in the given technology and having weak complementary assets. In that situation, it's probably more advantageous than not to, for a given technology, if the technology has value, to acquire the necessary complementary assets that can lead to the development or a strategic alliance or a joint venture or perhaps even license out the technology to have access to the complementary assets that can turn the technology into a product or into a service that might be offered. When the technology position is strong and the complementary asset base for the company is also strong, it makes the most sense to take that technology and manufacture or sell a product or service that incorporates that technology. Similarly, when the technology position is weak and the complementary asset base is weak, it may just be a bridge too far. It may be something that the company just should decide to either sell the technology or abandon the technology asset, realizing that it's going to take a lot in the way of complementary assets or significant improvements in their position, in their technology position, to take this particular innovation into a financial result. If the technology position is weak, but the complementary asset base is strong, then it may make sense instead to acquire technology that will permit the company to leverage its complementary asset base to further develop, to develop a strategic alliance, to enter into a joint venture, or to license in the resources that it needs in order to take the technology to the marketplace. Another view or process view for this approach can be seen in the following diagram. Let's say that you have a particular innovation. This diagram shows you some of the options that a company might pursue in converting that innovation into a financial result. If the innovation meets a market need, then it has the ability to move upward in this diagram. If it does not, then the best option probably is either to store or abandon the technological innovation. If the innovation meets a market need, then the next question is to ask, is protection a competitive issue? If it is, will protection lead to a competitive position in the marketplace? Then the next question is adequate intellectual property protection available? If it's not, if you've abandoned the invention or done something, or if for other reasons it's not possible to obtain protection, intellectual property protection, then the next best, or the alternative there, leads to storing the technology. It may be useful later, but it doesn't make sense to pursue the technology further if protection is a competitive issue. If intellectual property protection is available, then the next step is to determine, can the protection be made a competitive issue? If it can be, then we move forward. If it cannot, then the next best alternative, the next step is to store the technology. If it can be made a competitive issue, if protection of the technology can be made a competitive issue, and if the technology itself can be made a competitive issue in the marketplace for the company, then the next inquiry is to determine whether commercialization requires specific complementary assets. If it does, then the next question becomes, can the need for specific assets be created? Well, if they can be created, then we move forward. If the specific assets can't be further created, then the next step is to consider out-licensing the technology or otherwise contracting to take the technology, to take the innovation, and to create some form of revenue stream from that technology. If commercialization requires specific assets, specific complementary assets, then the next step is to question whether their critical assets are available in-house. If they're not available in-house, then you need to ask the question, are the resources available to build them? If the resources are available to build them, then we move on. But if they're not, if the complementary asset base is weak and we don't have the wherewithal to develop these critical assets in-house, then this is the point at which a joint venture or strategic alliance probably makes good sense. If the critical assets are available in-house, we move forward to the next inquiry of whether competitors are in a better position to exploit the opportunity. If they're not, we've gone through this analysis, it probably makes sense at this point to integrate the innovation into our technology, into our products, so that we can compete with that new technology, assuming that it, again, meets the market need. That's the threshold consideration. If, on the other hand, our competitors are in a better position, do we have the opportunity to catch up, either with this innovation or with other efforts? If we do, this leads us back to the integration of the technology into the product, into the services that we offer in the marketplace. If, on the other hand, we can't catch up, then it may make sense to enter into a joint venture or a strategic alliance with someone other than our competitor, for the purpose of being in a more strategic and more advantageous position. And clearly, this simplifies the process, but at the same time, it may even simplify the process of whether or not to use an innovation. But it leads to, or can help lead to, an analysis of whether it makes sense to commercialize a given innovation. In the licensing context, remember, we've got some licensing considerations here. With the joint venture or strategic alliance, there are going to be certain licensing considerations. In the following discussion, we're going to get into more detail with regard to what are the possibilities in licensing. Before we get there, though, with a particular innovation, it's important to understand where the potential licensor is relative to the potential licensee. This diagram provides an analytical tool that suggests the approach that can be taken with the licensing. With a strategic licensor versus an opportunistic licensor relative to a seeker of technology or an infringer of a seeker of intellectual property rights, an infringer of intellectual property rights. The strategic licensor, when confronted with the seeker of technology, usually in that context, they're both sides are interested in an exchange and negotiations are likely to be smooth. When the infringer, on the other hand, exists and they have a strategic licensor, there are going to be significant differences. The licensor is going to be seeking, more likely than not, a maximum royalty. The licensee, on the other hand, will be seeking a minimum royalty, probably because his profit model has already been established, and to be approached by a strategic licensor, the infringer is going to have, you're cutting into the profits of that licensee, and so the negotiations are likely to be difficult. When an opportunistic licensor exists, strategic licensor is, just to back up a little bit, a strategic licensor is a licensor of technology for which licensing of technology, licensing of intellectual property rights, is part and parcel of what that company does. The opportunistic licensor, on the other hand, is a licensor that's come up with an innovation or found that it has a technology that doesn't necessarily fit within the product offerings of the company, but does have the opportunity, or that could be a license revenue stream opportunity for the company, for the holder of those intellectual property rights. In this situation, the licensor is likely to seek royalty in terms at industry norms. Reason being, they just don't have experience. And so looking at industry norms, using ballpark figures is what the opportunistic licensor is probably going to be operating from. The licensee, again, a seeker of technology, understanding what the market is, will likely agree, and the negotiations are likely to be non-contentious, probably negotiated to some degree, but not difficult. On the other hand, where the opportunistic licensor confronts an infringer, the licensor will seek industry norms because of the fact, in terms of the royalty rates, in terms of the compensation for the use of the intellectual property rights, the licensor will again seek industry norms. They usually don't have an income stream model or other model that tells them what their intellectual property valuation is. The licensee will try to reduce below the industry norms, probably for any reason, because of the fact that the profit model and the business opportunities of the licensor, of the licensee, will have been set. The negotiations are likely to be serious but not contentious, may or may not lead to litigation. Well, you have a strategic licensor and an infringer, more likely than not, you're going to get into litigation. With the opportunistic licensor and the infringer, the likelihood is that you'll be less prone to get into a litigious situation. In the licensing process, there's certain things that go on. There may be a request for the information or request to begin the licensing negotiation. And at the beginning of this relationship between the licensor and the licensee, there'll be an input of non-confidential data. That non-confidential data will at least show what the technology can do and why it may be advantageous for the licensee. The licensee may conduct a preliminary evaluation. The stakeholders can be identified as to who would be most benefited by the technology and what the preliminary approval steps will be for the purpose of conducting a licensing negotiation, conducting a licensing transaction. The conflict review, one of the things that happens with the licensing of technology that needs to happen when you license in technology, particularly in larger companies, is to determine where there might be business conflicts are company conflicts between the licensor and the licensee. Once the conflict review occurs and is completed and it makes business sense for a licensee and a licensor to do business, a secrecy agreement between the two will be established and the input of confidential data will occur. Those, the secret sauce, if you will, for the technology will be explained to the potential licensee. The potential licensee at that point in time, with the secrecy agreement, covered by the secrecy agreement and covered by the obligations relating to that, but now with confidential data that will let him, that will let the licensee understand the real value of the technology. He'll review and study, and there may be, and there should be, if the process continues, an output of a tentative agreement. The licensing team on each side, the attorneys, the if they haven't been already identified at this point in time, they will be identified, and then we'll go into the negotiation stage of the agreement. The negotiation will continue until the license is approved by both sides. Execution of the license agreement will occur. The parties will sign the agreement. The output will be the final agreement, and the implementation and termination of the process will occur, and the licensing will continue. The process will operate and exist during the term of the license agreement. The following diagram discusses some of the issues that relate to the process of licensing, intellectual property, licensing of technology, and they occur in the process flow. They include the technology or inventory assessment, the business assessment, the licensing potential and essentially a go, no-go type of decision, the licensing project development, what, who are the people involved in the process, the negotiation as mentioned before and the closing of the transaction and the implementation and administration of the agreement. In these various steps, there are things that need to take place that will be represented in the agreement. And we'll discuss some of the constituents of the license agreement. But the identification of the technology, documentation, determining the information relating to the technology, the organization of the who's involved in the licensing organization, the completeness of the technology, the strategic importance, all the types of things that we've mentioned before with regard to patenting of technology. Now we're going into the phase of establishing a transaction relating to that technology. What is the competitive advantage that the technology gives? What are the alternatives to the technology? From an intellectual property standpoint, it's important at this point to look at the modes of protection for the technology that you want to license or may want to license. Is the protection adequate? Due diligence is in order. We'll talk a little bit about due diligence. And then what is the freedom to operate in the technology? Remember in an earlier module, I explained the difference between the rights that a patent gives you and the rights to practice your invention. Well, freedom to operate has to do with the fact that the licensor may have patents in operating it that cover the innovation, but without a freedom to operate in light of patents that precede the patent that the inventor or that the licensor may have, the freedom to operate may be minimal at best, and for that reason, it's important to do the diligence that determines the value and the freedom to operate of the patents that would be covered for, that would be covering the technology that would be licensed. Business assessment, here we're going into some of the conflict issues, some of the relevant business terms of the size and the growth rate of the market. What is the structure of the market for using the technology? Who are the players in the competition, the size, growth, the competitive advantages at the business level with regard to a new technology, the potential niche that it might occupy? How does this technology permit the differentiation of the company or of the offered product in the marketplace? Are there other risks to consider? What are the other risks? How do you identify those? Thinking through those issues. That's a creative process, but they need to be considered. And then the potential licensees, sub-licensees, and potential other licensees with regard to the business case assessment. Now, with regard to the licensing of technology, and if you look at these two prior steps as what might be the determining factors for licensing a technology from a company, the licensing, this type of gate review, having done this assessment of a potential technology to license in that commercialization phase, if the questions for licensing indicate that it makes sense to license this technology, then of course what you'll do, what the companies will do, will add the technology, add the intellectual property to the licensing inventory. If there are gaps that need to be addressed with regard to either the intellectual property or the technology, then the next step would be, instead of moving forward and developing a licensing project from the technology, there would be the need to go back and fill and modify anything that stands out as a deficiency here. And then further, if after looking at these business assessment matters and technology or inventory assessment matters, it's determined that it doesn't make sense to proceed with the licensing of the technology, then it certainly makes sense at that point to put an end to the process and move forward. But again, as to the potential licensor, potential licensee, these issues are extremely relevant and can be determinative as to whether a transaction can occur. Now, going into further dealing with the potential for licensing of the technology, if the yes decision exists, the process further leads us to the project development of how are we going to license this technology? Who are we going to license it to? How do we develop this if a potential licensee has not already been identified? Evaluation, risk assessment, going into the project, defining the project, technology marketing, if we're going to do this, how we're going to do this, terms development, terms for the agreement, the license agreement, and then the qualification of licensees when they haven't been identified. Moving forward, once the potential licensees have been identified, or if they already have been identified through this process, the next step in the process is to negotiate and close, and these issues in developing the negotiating strategies, how we're going to bargain, what are the terms, how we're going to achieve a business relationship between the licensor and the licensee, these are issues that are very business-oriented issues, but they have to do essentially with the translation of the technology and the related intellectual property into the marketplace. And then from this point forward, once we've closed the transaction, we've got a final license agreement, and we've moved forward, we then have the phase of living with the agreement, living with the relationship.